Hi, this is Mike Megali and Manos Brilakis from the Minneapolis Heart Institute and the Cardiovascular Innovations Foundation, presenting case 59 for the Manual of Percutaneous Coronary Interventions. This is a case of a double provisional stenting technique for two bifurcations in a patient with heavy coronary calcium. The patient was an elderly woman who presented with a non-ST elevation myocardial infarction with mild troponin elevation. She had a known CTO of the right coronary artery and had a diffuse disease in the distal left main as well as the proximal and medial AD, which made it challenging to identify the culprit lesion for the patient's current presentation. Even though in the setting of MI we don't do coronary physiology, in this particular case it was very mild troponin elevation, and we did perform an IFR of the LAD that was 0.47 with step-ups at the proximal to mid as well as the left main. The patient came off the table and had discussion with the family given multiple areas of complexity. Her EF was slightly decreased to 46%, however the myocardium was viable. And the patient was considered very high risk for surgery even though she had diabetes because of her age mainly, and she was referred for complex percutaneous coronary intervention. These are the steps of PCI, which are important to consider when planning for a complex intervention like this one. This patient has severe coronary calcium. Also, there's a CTO of the right, therefore we are treating the last remaining vessel. The target lesion is going to be the LAD and the left main. And because of the heavy calcification, we consider that orbital atherectomy of some sort would be required. And also, we're going to do imaging to ensure we have good stent expansion and also hemodynamic support, given that this was the last remaining vessel. So the patient came and we first did the right heart catheterization, which is very useful in patients with complex PCI, which actually wasn't too bad with low pulmonary capillary wedge pressure and pulmonary artery pressure. We nevertheless decided to still use hemodynamic support given the right coronary artery CTO. The patient did have good size femoral arteries, so we obtained bilateral femoral access and then pre-closed the left common femoral using two sutures at 10 o'clock and then 2 o'clock, and then inserted an Impella CP device for hemodynamic support during the case. After doing that, we decided to start with the procedure. We wired easily the LAD using a workhorse guide wire, and then we perform intravascular ultrasound that demonstrated severe circumferential calcification in the LAD. There was also some calcium going into the left main that was of good caliber without significant disease. The question always comes whether atherectomy should be done in patients with severe calcification. And in general, unless they have factors that increase the complexity and the risk of atherectomy, atherectomy may have the advantage for the severely calcified circumferential lesions. This patient did not have significant tortuosity in the LAD and the main. There was no thrombus, there was no dissection, and there was no bypass graft. Therefore, we decided to start with atherectomy. Either atherectomy, rotational or orbital, could be done. There was no previous stent. In this particular case, we decided to do orbital atherectomy. And there are specific steps we use for doing atherectomy for either device. We use our standard workhorse wire to wire and then a microcatheter to insert the atherectomy wire, the Viper in this case. We use trapping to do the exchanges of the microcatheter. And then we prepare the device outside the body. For orbital atherectomy, it's the exact opposite than rotational. Advancement is very, very slow. And we essentially almost always use the slow speed. We use the 80,000 RPM. By advancing slowly, one can get a good atherectomy result. The key thing is to limit the duration of atherectomy to short time interval, usually 15 to 25 seconds. We don't want long intervals for the reason I'll show you in the next slide. And we want also long times of recovery between the atherectomy rounds. The reason is that the debris liberated may actually plug up distal microcirculation. This is analogous to pushing flour down the sink. If a lot of flour is released, then that may plug up the sink. Whereas if the flour is released slowly, then the water flow can actually drain it down in the sink. And then we want to also always, for both kinds of atherectomy, have significant distance between the tip of the atherectomy catheter and the radiopaque portion of the guide wire. The reason is we don't want to get the atherectomy to come close and potentially cut and embolize the distal portion of the guide wire. So in this particular case, we used a standard microcatheter, a Caravel, and a Sion blue wire. Then we removed the Sion and exchanged for a Viper guide wire, over which we did multiple runs, actually a total of 13 runs. There was a significant sound suggestive of deceleration going from the left main into the LAD and the proximal to mid LAD. Our duration was 15 to 20 seconds per run, and then we left at least 30 to 40 seconds between runs to allow for recovery of the microcirculation. We then removed the Viper wire and then insert another workhorse wire, and then we wired into the circumflex using the knuckle wire technique that advanced nicely down the circumflex, and did repeat intravascular ultrasound that showed some improvement. There's obviously still calcium, but there's some improvement in the stenosis of the LAD. Before implanting stents, after we do atherectomy, we always want to check that the balloons are expanding, because sometimes if they are not, one may need to do additional atherectomy runs or do some other plaque modification. In this particular case, we used 3O balloons and actually also an angiosculpt that did show good expansion. The challenge is that there were two bifurcations covered by the stents. One is an LAD diagonal, and then distal left main. And the most important, of course, is the distal left main, and the circumflex is a branch that needs to be preserved. However, there was not significant disease on the ostium of the circ, therefore the likelihood of occlusion was low. We decided to use a provisional stenting strategy, using a wire in the side branch and then stenting over the ostium of the circumflex. We first stented into the proximal to mid LAD with a 3.0x38 stent that jailed the LAD diagonal bifurcation. We thought the chance of losing this diagonal branch was low, that's why we did not wire it. And then we used a second long 3.5x33 diagluting stent all the way from the left main into the proximal LAD, overlapping the initial stent that was also deployed, providing a nice result. Both diagonal and circumflex are still in place. However, there are still potentially some areas of poor stent expansion, and that is why we used a 3.5 millimeter NC balloon and post-dilated both stents with a nice result, as shown by intravascular ultrasound. There is some oval shape of the stents, but the area was good, and there was no significant residual disease in either the left main or the LAD. So a nice final result was achieved in the LAD without affecting the diagonal or the circumflex. The patient was fine during the case, so the Impella was removed at the end. The perclosed sutures were tightened. There's some stenosis, but we decided to not treat that. We always like to take a picture from the contralateral side if we have access to confirm that there is no bleeding and good hemostasis has been achieved. Then the patient did have a good result and an eventful recovery. Several conclusions from this case. The first is that hemodynamic support may improve the safety. In cases like this, even though the hemodynamics were okay, this was essentially PCI of the last remaining vessel, giving the right coronary artery CTO, and given the decreased ejection fraction, Impella improved the safety of the procedure in case something went wrong. Second, in cases of heavy calcification, in the absence of significant tortuosity or dissection or thrombus, atherectomy can help achieve stent expansion. And finally, for treating bifurcations when the chance of losing the side branch is low, provisional stenting with a crossover stent across the ostium of the side branch, which we typically wire before, is the preferred strategy. And as shown in this case, it worked pretty well. Thank you.